cold. Good morning, Bridgeway. How is everybody this morning? Well, it's good to see you all here this morning. If you're joining us online, welcome. We're going to get to our baptisms in just a second, and we're certainly excited about that. We hope you're staying warm. We're going to worship together as we normally do. We're going to start off with some singing, so would you stand with me?
Thank you. All right, you guys can have a seat.
That's the first time anybody's done the gritty during our worship. That was awesome.
Yeah, that was Kyson Harmon doing, yeah. So exciting day here at Bridgeway. We got some baptisms. If you're getting baptized, just come on up here and then we need to make a path for them guys to be able to get to where Andrew is. Before we do this, we do have one order of church business. Miss Jane Hogan. Jane, put your hand up there. Excuse me. Is wanting to be a member of the church. She's been through a membership class. And Austin and Aaron Spiller over here. You guys put your hands up. Also been through a membership class. Wanting to be members here at Bridgeway. So all in favor of adding them to our membership, please say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Welcome to the family. And be sure to stick around. We'll get your picture after church. So baptism, if you're not familiar with what it is the outward representation of what Christ has done in us when we get saved. And so these folks today are publicly proclaiming that they have decided to follow Jesus Christ. So first up, we'll have Mr. Blake come on up here. Come on in, buddy. Mm-hmm. Scoot up just a little bit. Have a seat right there. Blake, have you received Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
It's your desire to live for him from this day forward.
Yes, I have.
Blake, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Come on over here. Now, Blake's son, Pierce, come on up here, big guy. He's wanting to get baptized today as well, and his dad is going to baptize him. So, Blake, I'll give this to you. You have a seat right there, buddy. Cross your arms there. Go right ahead, Blake. It's all right, buddy. It's good stuff.
You're going to probably have to talk.
I'll do the talking. Blake, have you received Christ as your Lord and Savior? Is your desire to live for him from this day forward?
Yep.
Upon your profession of faith in Lord Jesus Christ, your dad baptizes you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death. Raised in the likeness of his resurrection. That's awesome. All right, buddy. Yeah, that's awesome. All right, Miss Ellie. Need that right there. Here we go, sis. Come right this way. If we get in there. All right, this is Ellie Sanchez, and go ahead and sit down right there, Ellie. Mom and Dad, you're all in position how you want to be. Okay. You can just sit down on the bottom. Put your feet in front of you. There you go. Ellie, have you received Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior? You desire to live for him from this day forward? Ellie, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Great job. Can you get out of your face? You go right this way over to Andrew. He got a towel for you. And Nick, come on over here, bud. Excuse me. That's awesome. Nick wanted to say something before he gets in the water. Nick, go right ahead.
I just want to thank all of my family and everybody in the community for doing what they do and being here. My entire life, everything that I've planned for myself didn't exactly work out. But everything that God has planned for me, perfect. And that's it. That's why I'm here. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Dick. All right, Nick. Nick, have you received the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior? It's your desire to live for him from this day forward.
Yes.
Nick, upon your profession of faith in Lord Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Congratulations, buddy.
Thank you.
It's all wet.
All right, Rach, come on up to give us some announcements.
Rachel,
let's give it up for him one more time.
We got more towels.
You're right. All right, kids, you are dismissed. Thanks for being in here, guys. You know what to do. I ain't worried about this as much as I'm worried about the rest of that. So you can take this one and use it too.
You guys can fill out the little bulletin card that you have.
Good. Okay.
And we donate $10 to a Child's Hope International for every communication card that a guest fills out. And that $10 feeds a child for an entire month. And then... men, you guys have small group this Wednesday at 7 p.m.
It's actually not at 7, right? Is it
6? 6:30. Yep. at Stephen Turton's house. I don't know if you guys can wait. Oh, hello. Yeah. It'll be at the shop there. There is heat, so you will be covered this week. And then family worship is Sunday, January 21st. At 5 p.m., and it's actually also a potluck, so please bring a side dish, dessert. You can bring anything that you want for that. Effective parenting in an effective world. That class starts February 4th at 9 a.m. You can still sign up. The QR code on the back of your chairs, you can scan to sign up for that as well. And then the student center is now 33% funded. Last week, I think it was 27%, so we're going up there. We still need, we've got 16 and a half of our 50 givers, so I don't know the math on that, but we need some more. So we're really excited about that though. For the Student Center Fund, you can just scan the QR code. And then that all goes for our Student Center Ministry. That will begin February 4th at 5:30 p.m. It'll be here. We've got a bunch of other churches that are interested. All we need is for the parents to get their kids here, and we'll take care of the rest. It'll be fun. And then if anyone wants to join the worship team, you can see Brandon for details on that. And yeah, that's it. I'll just say a closing prayer, and then we'll get back to worship. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. God, we ask that you bless our time here together. You are worthy of all the praise and worship. God, please continue to call your children to use their spiritual gifts for your discipleship, to continue spreading your word. God, we thank you for those who came today to publicly declare their faith. We love you, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Would you stand as we continue our worship?
To the Lord in prayer.
been a good morning so far. Can you change the slide so I can get some lights on me there, Joe? I feel dark up here. Anybody else? Is it dark in here or is it just me? I don't know. Brandon, I'll let you deal with that. So a couple things before we get started in our series for John, with John, the apostle. If you didn't get a catechism book, there are extras out at the guest services table. And then we have these little blue notebooks for the Gospel of John. If you want to grab one of those to keep with you during the duration, that would be awesome. And another thing, man, it's just been an awesome morning. Memberships, baptisms, gathering together. And today is one of Bridgeway, our families. We have one little member. It's our first time at church, little Miss Abigail Cooper, right there in the back. Coopers, put your hand up, please. Little Miss Abigail's back there somewhere. And as always, look with your eyes, not with your hands. When you see the little, I know they're cute and you just want to cuddle them and all that good stuff, but we don't want to get Miss Abby sick. But anyways, it's nice. More babies. It's awesome. So we're going to start our series in the Gospel of John, and it's going to take us a while. This is a what we would call an expository series, where we go verse by verse for however long it takes through a book of the Bible. And again, I anticipate this to take us a very long time because there is a lot to cover. And there are different types of sermon series that us pastors do. We have topical series where we'll have a topic and we'll talk about something specific. Like last week, we did our first catechism. And so each time we have our catechism Sundays, that's a topical sermon. And then we have a textual series, which is going through like a part of a book of the Bible, kind of like what we did with Daniel and Elijah. We went through different parts of the book of the Bible and breaking down their journey. And so think of expository preaching kind of like eating an elephant. It's just one bite at a time. And it's going to take a little while. As we go through this gospel, you're going to be challenged in different ways. I want you to go into this gospel with an open mind, because one of the ways we love the Lord our God is with all our might, all of our strength, all our heart, but also we love the Lord our God with our mind. And so we're going to come upon difficult passages. We're going to walk through them. And I want us to be challenged. I want us to be stretched. And maybe you're going to find some moments where even you're going to disagree with me. And we're allowed to disagree on things. You know, the old saying is we major on the majors and we minor on the minors. And so there's going to be some challenging passages that we're going to walk through that maybe we don't all agree upon. But I want you to be, all I'm asking you to do is to hear me out, okay? Hear me out when we come to those passages. Because typically, what sometimes happens for folks is when they have, we all come in to reading the Bible with our assumptions and our presuppositions, like we have that and we teach our kids, we lay a foundation for them, and that's all good. Many Christians, and I haven't taken a poll, but just in my 20 years of experience, many stop diving or learning, how do I put it, expanding upon what they've learned in like seventh grade. And they're like, well, I've learned this in middle school and maybe the beginning of high school. And so when they're 30 or 35 or older, and they default back to what they knew and was taught to them in seventh grade. We want to expand our mind and mature our faith. And so that means we're going to have to dive deep and we're going to maybe challenge some of those assumptions or presuppositions you have about different passages in here. So I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to us taking this journey. And you need to be praying, okay, Lord, what do you want to teach me through this journey, through your gospel? So first, let's pray. And then we've got an introduction. We've got to lay some groundwork before we can dive into this book. Lord God, it's been such a great morning. And most importantly, we are here, God. We get to worship you together. We get to see people take the next step in their faith journey. It's a wonderful morning, Lord. Now we get to open your word that you have inspired for us. And I know that your gospel here, the Gospel of John, is going to challenge us, enlighten us, and grow us in many ways. And we look forward to it, Lord. We love you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. We're going to try to answer a couple questions. Again, we're not going to get to John chapter 1, verse 1 today. We're going to lay some groundwork, okay? So the question we got to start with is, who wrote the Gospel of John? Well, duh, Brent, it's called the Gospel of John for a reason. Yet, when you read the entire Gospel of John, the author never identifies themselves. The author never says, I am John, and I am writing. So, for some, from a skeptic point of view, they simply would say, it's anonymous. You can't trust it because you don't know who wrote it. Well, this is a legit question that I think we should answer. So what I'm going to do as we walk through this is, what we're going to learn throughout this gospel are some things about the author. And I'm just going to highlight a few of those things that give us some evidence as to why we believe John wrote it. And so you take the evidence and you make a decision based on it, because none of us were there when this was written. I wasn't there right next to the guy writing it, but why do we believe it's John? So if you're taking notes, and by the way, the verses won't be on the screen when we're doing our John series. We want you to bring your Bibles, get in your Bibles. And so we'll only be using the screen when we're doing more topical based and we're jumping through a million different verses. Who wrote the Gospel of John? The first thing you're going to learn about the author is that the author is Jewish, not a Gentile. Why do we believe this? Because there are a ton of references to Jewish scriptures. In fact, there's over 20 references to different Jewish beliefs. And it's almost like the author is trying to break down some of these Jewish things to the readers, some of them would be Gentile. And a Gentile, a non-Jew, would not have the intimate knowledge about the Jewish faith that a Jew would. So we can start there. Mark that off the list. The author is Jewish. The author knows the terrain very well. So the one writing this isn't just some random outsider in Egypt writing about Jesus. He's from the area. And the reason we know this, well, when we read the text, for example, in John 2, it says they leave Cana in Galilee and go down into Capernaum. You would be familiar with this. So if we were saying, hey, I'm coming from Mount Orb and I'm going up to Eastgate, well, you have to go up Batavia Hill. You guys know where Batavia Hill is. We're familiar with the terrain. So if I'm going to Mount Orb, I'm going up to Eastgate, then I'm going up. I know that there's some elevation there. In John 5, after a Jewish festival takes place, it says that Jesus went up from Jerusalem to Cana. And once again, yeah, they are at different elevations, and the author is accurate. Bethany from Jordan is described with precision. So the author is familiar with how far certain towns are away from one another. If you're in Amelia and you're going to Bethel, it's about 8 miles. I know that I grew up in Bethel. We would come here if we needed anything that Bethel didn't have, which was a lot. And so it's 8 miles to, no, I'm not dogging Bethel, I'm from there. I can make fun of it. But he says in John 11 that Bethany was near Jerusalem about 2 miles away. The author mentions 5 different bodies of water, more than any other gospel writer. And this would make sense if the author is also a fisherman. Wouldn't a fisherman be familiar with the bodies of water that are in the area? Of course they would. So the author here, he has some local knowledge. So we know he's Jewish. We know he's from the area, familiar with the terrain. The author is also an eyewitness to Christ's ministry. In this gospel, the writer is the only one to mention Nicodemus, the only one to mention Lazarus or Malchus. That's the guy who gets his ear cut off. He mentions specific numbers, like there were 6 water pots when Jesus turned water into wine. The people told Jesus it took 46 years to build the temple. When Jesus was saying, hey, you know, in 3 days, you tear this temple down, I'll resurrect it. And they're like, well, it took 46 years. How are you going to do this? And what they misunderstood was Jesus is talking about his body, not the actual temple. So the person is there, and he hears these things and remembers them. He remembers that the Samaritan woman had 5 previous husbands, that the apostles rode for 3 or 4 miles before seeing Jesus walk on the water. In fact, let's turn to John 6 in your Bible. Go to John 6. Verse 19, I like to hear the pages rustling. That's nice, isn't it? John 6, 19, after they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea. He was coming near the boat, and they were afraid. So this person obviously knew how far away Jesus was, just guesstimating, you know, when they saw him walking on the water, which would have been quite a significant event to remember. The author also knows that Lazarus was dead for 4 days. He's mentioning all of these facts. If you look in John 21, it says that Simon Peter climbed up and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. So they're catching fish, and the author here knows exactly how many fish that they caught. More details, and I know I'm throwing a lot at you, but I'm trying to make a case for who the author is. This author isn't someone who just interviewed someone. It seems as if this author was there when these things happened. 5,000 barley loaves were used. The triumphant entry used palm branches. He mentions time frames a lot, the 10th hour, the 6th hour, the morning, night, and so on, as if he was there when these things were taking place. So we've got three things so far. We have that the author is Jewish. We have that the author is familiar with the terrain and an eyewitness to Jesus's ministry. Let's keep building our case here. The author is one of the 12. The author is familiar with scenes where only the disciples are present. He knows about their calling and trip to Samaria. He knows the other disciples' actions, thoughts, and feelings. So times when they were talking among themselves and Jesus isn't there, and he talks about their misunderstandings, that there were things that they just didn't get that Jesus was talking about. He even knew where Jesus would go to get away from people. And so this is certainly one of the 12. In order to have this kind of knowledge, this person has to be one of the 12. But let's narrow it down a little more. The author's present at the Last Supper. He joins Mary at the crucifixion. He runs with Peter to see the empty tomb. He's among the 7 that return to Galilee to encounter Jesus there. Jesus entrusts the care of his mother to the author. And this is significant because who were Jesus's inner three? It was Peter, James, and John. Jesus entrusts the author with the care of his mother. It can't be James because he's dead. He's killed in 44 AD. Peter is mentioned, but he's mentioned, the text distinguishes Peter from the author. So who does that leave us? Leaves us John. John is, another question is, well, why would Jesus entrust someone else with the care of his mother? Where's Joseph? Joseph, we believe, is dead. What about his brothers and sisters? His brothers and sisters don't believe that Jesus is Messiah, because Mary and Joseph had other children. The book of James is written by Jesus' half-brother, who doesn't believe Jesus is the Christ until after the resurrection. And so you have John here that's left. He makes the most sense to fit the category. All of the evidence seems to point to John. Early church fathers believed it was John. So it was kind of common knowledge by the second century that John was the one who wrote the gospel. Justin Martyr writes about him. Irenaeus, who was a disciple, a follower of Polycarp. Polycarp was a follower of John. According to church tradition, John leads Polycarp to faith. Polycarp leads Irenaeus to faith. And Polycarp tells Irenaeus that John wrote this gospel. Clement, Tertullian, all refer to John's authorship. So we're making a little bit of a case here. Okay, so the author is Jewish. He knows the terrain. He's an eyewitness. He's one of the 12. Jesus entrusts the care of his mother to him, and early church leaders believe that John wrote it. So, Though the author doesn't mention his name, I think it's reasonable to conclude that John wrote this gospel. It's not as anonymous as skeptics would have you to believe. When did John write it? Probably in the 60s, but before 70 AD, and I'll get to why I believe it was before 70 AD. But it is believed that John's gospel was written last. Here's a couple reasons why we believe that. John wrote as if his readers already knew the apostles. The first three gospels are referred to as the synoptic gospels because they have a lot in common. There's a lot of stories that are shared among them. When you get to John, there's very few similarities. There's a few things that are in all four gospels, but John is vastly different than the rest. And it's believed that John did this because he assumed they already know what Matthew, Mark, and Luke wrote. And so I'm going to give them more information. He also refers to, again, he's assuming people know who the apostles are. And if you're still in chapter 6 of John, verse 66, says, from that moment, many of his disciples turned back and no longer accompanied him. So Jesus said to the 12, you don't want to go away too, do you? Notice he makes no effort to say who the apostles are. He simply refers to them as the 12. So he's assuming that the person reading, I know our building sounds like it's going to fall apart, but trust me, it'll stay up there. Anytime it's windy, it talks to us, freaks everybody out, and rightfully so. But he makes no effort to try to identify who these 12 people are because he's assuming the reader already knows who the 12 are. So the next part is John wrote as though his readers already knew about John the Baptist. He doesn't go into great detail to identify John the Baptist because the other gospels already do that. If you back up a few pages in your Bible to John chapter 3. You can go back just a little bit. Verse 23. John was also baptizing in Aenon near Salem because there was plenty of water there. People were coming and being baptized since John had not yet been thrown into prison. And John gets thrown into prison and his head gets cut off. And so he's writing as if they know this. Like, John's baptizing, he ain't been thrown into prison yet, guys. Because you know he gets thrown into prison later. So he's laid that out for them. You know who John is. He doesn't bother going into any more detail. So he assumes they know who the apostles are. He assumes they know who John the Baptist is, so he doesn't go into those details. Why do I think it's written before 70 AD? Because there is a significant event that happens in history in 70 AD. It's when the Romans destroy the temple. This is a terrible event that takes place, but nonetheless, Jesus predicted this, and it comes to pass. Surely John would have mentioned that. That's why I don't think it was written, some say it's 80s or 90s when he wrote, but I believe John would have mentioned that this event took place because of its significance. And then early church fathers, as we've referred to already, say that John's gospel came last. They affirm John's authorship, and they affirm that his gospel was the last gospel. So this gives a little bit of framework as we're looking into this biography of Jesus. And if you're not familiar with the gospels are basically biographies of Jesus Christ. Excuse me. And how they write biographies is a bit different than how we would write biographies. They're going to emphasize more on Jesus's ministry than anything else. That's why we don't know, you know, between 12 and 30, you know, it's like, well, what was Jesus doing during those times? We don't know because the Bible doesn't tell us. If we're writing our biographies, I mean, we go through, Brent's born in Bethel and goes to school and so on and so forth. Like, we would be detailed of every stage of life. It's not like that. and ancient biographies. So there's a little bit of framework. Now let's learn about this guy, John, okay? One of the arguments against Christianity, we've already covered one of them, that the Gospels are anonymous, in particular John. But two, and I've seen this on some TikTok videos, don't get your theology from TikTok videos, okay? I mean, 30 seconds to misrepresent a view is quite easy to do, and that happens most of the time. But one of them I saw was, there is no way that the authors of the Gospels are who you know their names are. And their argument was, if you were to go back in that time and ask for John or Matthew, like, come on, those are English names. Of course, there's no John or Matthew. Like, you got to be kidding me to think that a John or a Matthew wrote these Gospels, because that just sounds like such an American English kind of thing. And to a degree, they would be right. If you went back in that time and said, hey, I really want to meet John, they wouldn't know who you're talking about. Now, if you asked for Yohanan, they would know exactly who you're talking about. Because, believe it or not, to my skeptic friends, the Bible was not written in English to start. And some of the names given have an English form now. John is the English form of the Hebrew Yohanan. So if you want to refer to it as the book of Yohanan, you're welcome to. You would be accurate. In English, we say John, just like Matthew. If you went and you're like, I really need to talk to Matthew, you know, the tax collector who became a follower of Jesus, people are just going to look at you like you got two heads. Now, if you said, I need to talk to Matiashu, then they would be like, oh, yeah, that's who I'm talking about. Why? Because that's how you say it in Hebrew. That's what his name was. But I don't speak Hebrew, and we speak English, and so we have the English form, Matthew. So if you see those things pop up, his name in English is John, but in Hebrew, it's Yohanan. The Apostle John is the author of 5 New Testament books. So you have his gospel, you have 3 short epistles, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and then you have the book of Revelation. As I mentioned earlier, John is a part of Jesus' inner circle, along with Peter and James, and he's one of the ones that had the privilege of seeing Jesus have a conversation with Moses and Elijah. Like, that's cool. His importance grows, I mean, because he's kind of the young guy among the group. It was different beliefs about how old John was. Some say he's 17, but no older than 30. He's a young man, the youngest among the group. He lives the longest as well. And his importance grows as his ministry grows. He ends up on an Isle of Patmos where he receives the visions of the book of Revelation. And then there's different ideas of how he died. I don't know how he died, so I can't really say. There's traditions that he was boiled in oil. Others say he wasn't martyred at all. He just died of old age. So I don't know. But he's the youngest apostle. So I hope that gives you a little bit of framework. We know who wrote it. At least we have good reason to believe John wrote it. And we can see why he took the approach he took, believing other people knew who John the Baptist was, other people knew who the apostles were, when he wrote, probably before 70 AD. But now let's talk in short, why does he write this? Why does John take this on? You ever seen this show, This Is Us? Bit of a dramatic show. Whitney liked that show a lot, and I would have to watch it sometimes. Okay. The mom dies at the end. Okay. I hope that ruined for you. I'm sorry. What happens in this show is they have these flashbacks and like flash forwards. It's done really well. You know, they go back to when some of the main characters are kids, and you know why they are the way they are to a certain degree. And so you'll see this flashback, and then you have these flash forwards, you know, of, you know, what's happening when they're older and whatnot. And it's going back and forth. And There's this old saying, and I agree with it. Pastor Duke's the one who says it all the time. He says that young men dream and old men reflect. Young men dream and old men reflect, and that's true. You know, the older you get, the more you have to reflect upon. The younger you are, you know, the future, there's so many possibilities, and so you've got dreams and goals and things you're working towards. And so what I want you to do as we are in this gospel, I want you to travel back about 2,000 years, and we're going to kind of zoom in on this Middle Eastern-looking house. You know, go looking through the window, we see this kind of an older gentleman. He's probably in his 60s or so. I say kind of older because the older you get, you push that up, right? And so you see him, it's night. He's got this little oil lamp that's lighting his table. And he's sitting there with some parchment in front of him. He gets his stylus, which is kind of like a quill. He dips it in some ink and he starts writing. And from time to time, he stops. Maybe he prays. Maybe he smiles a little bit. There are times where tears are hitting the parchment because what he's writing is painful to remember. And he's undertaken this task of writing a biography of the most important person to ever walk the face of the planet. So each time he comes to a different section, it brings out different emotions in him, different challenges. You know, it's interesting how simple things in our life can remind us of stuff. You know, sometimes it's a song that you hear. Like you hear a song and it instantly takes you back to maybe the first time you heard it. Or you play a video game. This is for my, you know, friends born in the 80s and 90s. But it takes you back to this room where you're sitting as a kid. And you remember that moment. The other day I went to We Buy Games, you know, I trade some stuff in and need to get my store credit, and I wanted to buy this game called Pinball on the Nintendo Entertainment System. I forgot how bad the game was. My brother Brian reminded me later, like, how disappointed he was in the game as a kid, because I thought there was different levels to it, you know, but I just remember getting this pinball game, and there's these little penguins on it, and there's a special bonus stage where Mario's running around with this thing, hitting the pinball, and so I'm excited to get the kids, you know, let's play pinball. For one, it was Rhett's first time, and he absolutely destroyed me. But two, after like 2 minutes, they're like, so this is it? I'm like, yeah, pretty much. But it was that moment of, you know, being in my bedroom with my brothers playing this lame game that we got. And so I can imagine as on a much greater level, of course, as John's writing about Nicodemus and the Samaritan woman, the misunderstandings of the apostles, some smiles come across his face and some tears come across his face. Why did he write this? We believe it's under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. God wanted you to know what was going to be in this biography. That's why you're here 2,000 years later, and it's right here in front of you. I mean, how many books do you read that are 2,000 years old? So John's writing this section here about his buddy Thomas. And thinking about old Tom and how he wouldn't believe that Jesus had risen from the dead unless he could stick his finger in his hands and in his side. And he's just writing about it, probably with a little smirk on his face. Thomas didn't believe this. And he's probably thinking to himself, you should have seen the look on his face when he shows up. He's like, bam, here's my hand, Tom. Here's my side. Thomas falls to his knees, "My Lord, my God." It's after this. John tells us why he wrote this. Go to John 20 in your Bible. We're going to look at verse 30. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. Just pause there for a second. There's plenty not written in this book. In fact, in the next chapter, John 21, 25, he says, "And there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if every one of them were written down, I suppose not even the world itself could contain the books that would be written." Isn't that cool? The last verse in his gospel, he's like, listen, Jesus did so many things. If we tried to write them down, there's not enough books, there's not enough parchment, there's not enough ink. Doesn't that make you a little bit curious? Man, what else did Jesus do? Back to verse 30. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this. Okay, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. You want to know why John wrote this biography? He wrote this so you would believe. All these pages, all these moments, all of it is, it's got one goal in mind for the reader. He wants you to know that Jesus isn't a fake. That this isn't some fairy tale of Santa Claus or the Easter Bunny that we believe in. But that these are historical things that actually took place because the author is there. He saw it with his own eyes. And he remembers all that took place here. So we're going to travel through 21 chapters. And my hope for you and you watching online, if you're not a follower of Christ, by the end of chapter 21, verse 25, my hope is that changed. This gospel is written for you so that you will believe. And for those of us who are believers, who are already followers of Christ, this journey through 21 chapters, it should strengthen you. It should mature you. When we come to verse 25 in a few years, you guys, I'm not kidding, it's gonna take a long time. When we finally end on verse 25, I hope you look back and think, man, I have grown so much by carefully examining this biography that God inspired John to write. I am not the same. And there are plenty of people in your circle of influence who don't know Christ. And man, we want verse 31 to be that reality for them. This is written for them. And for us who already follow Christ, to share that truth. Because think about what John's doing here. He cares so much about the gospel. He cares so much about what Christ is doing and this movement that started 2,000 years ago. He wants people to know what happened. And so it has to be written down. The eyewitnesses, they're all dying off at this point from persecution or just naturally. This needs to be recorded so that 2,000 years later, in Amelia, Ohio, a preacher can get up and proclaim this to all of you. That should give you some connection to this journey that we're going to take. Jesus is the Messiah. And if you're not convinced, I hope you will be. Let's pray. Let's bow together, church. I thank you for your time. I hope this has laid an efficient foundation for you as we explore the Gospel of John. We have good evidence and good reason to believe that John wrote this. We can see why he took the approach that he took. Excuse me. And we know ultimately why he wrote this. And as we're having our moment of prayer, I hope we'll take some time as fellow followers of Christ. I want you to think of someone that John was writing to. He's writing to those so that they would believe. I want you to think of that person. That whether they come to this church or not, I want you to think of that person. I want you to pray for them. Lord, these things were written so that they could believe, and I hope, I pray that they will come to know Christ. If you're watching online and you have questions about faith, about Jesus, you know, we want to help you with that. You can put a question mark in the comment section, or you can send us a message. If you're in this room, by all means, reach out to us, whether talking to me personally or Pastor Brandon, or sending us an email or a phone call. We are accessible, and we will get back to you. But to have the courage, take that step. Almighty God, I thank you for this first step in the journey that lay before us. You're going to challenge us. You're going to stretch us. And you're going to grow us. I believe that at the end of these 21 chapters, Bridgeway will be a more faithful, mature followers of Christ than they are right now. That will grow in significant ways in our faith. For those who are not followers of Christ, I pray that John's prayer comes to pass, that you know these things are written so that they would believe, and we want them to come to know Christ. And so I pray that this helps direct them to that. We pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. Let's stand. We'll sing before we're dismissed.
Amen. You guys are dismissed. We'll see you next week. Have a great week. Stay warm.